So I'm just going to do a sketchbook session here, and my subject is shoes, specifically hiking boots. What I'm going to do is start with the larger forms and break those down and then work up to more detail. One thing to note, it is helpful if you don't already know to do this, but to actually angle your drawing surface or your painting surface toward you rather than keeping it flat. And that gives you a better line of sight so that you're looking, if not directly perpendicular to your drawing surface, it is at least angled toward you. That means you're not going to be drawing something that's distorted, because if it's flat and the line of sight is at more of an angle, what's going to happen is that your drawing will appear elongated. So it's always a good idea to angle your surface toward you. So I've got two hiking boots, and we're just going to go for it. So first thing I'm going to do is get the general idea and the general angle. So this is called gesture. And the shoe is essentially a wedge. And then what I want to look at is placing guidelines or center lines, axes, that go with the form and then also across the form, because that's going to help you start fleshing out volume. So I'm laying things in fairly quickly and getting a basic idea of where things are going to sit. I'm also going to be looking at where lines and angles, where edges and angles actually seem to parallel each other, because that's going to help unify. That repetition of those angles will help unify the drawing. So I'm thinking more overall form than I am thinking edge and contour at this point. Now the farther boot is farther away, and it's going to be a bit smaller. And I'm rethinking where I'm placing that, so it's not up here, because I'm noticing that this right here and this over here are on the same level vertically. So that's going to give me better accuracy. And then the bottom of the boot, its lowest point is inserting right about here on the near boot. And I'm going to be looking for those same things here. I'm going to be looking for basically the center axis of the boot. And then the cross axes. And that immediately starts giving us a sense of planes, and those intersecting planes give us a sense of volume. And basically the drawing doesn't look at all like anything yet. It's just setting things up. So I'm not starting out with contour and just trying to draw contour. What I'm looking at is the whole thing. And once I get the whole thing set up and proportions established, then I can start drilling down into the details. And one thing, I am not an academic when it comes to drawing. I'm very sketchy. My technique is very loose. I do look for those planes. I do look for structure, because without structure and overall large form to small form, large shape to small detail, the drawing's not going to look like anything. But I can make it look like something even though my technique is very sketchy. My sketching style, it's just the way I sketch. I'm very sketchy. I don't do academically rendered drawings. Notice also how I'm holding the pencil a lot and I'm using my whole arm and not just my wrist. So that's also an important understanding. One of the things that you can do to get used to this kind of movement and this kind of drawing and this way of holding your pencil is to do warm-up sketches. And warm-up sketches would simply be things like this, where you're getting used to sketching with your entire hand. So these are warm-up exercises. And you can see the greater movement. It involves the arm all the way into the shoulder. So now I'm going to look at the bigger details. And I'm starting at this point to look at contour. And I'm noticing, say, where this contour is an exterior, it's describing the exterior of the form, but then it dives inside the interior territory and becomes an interior contour. And this is actually a seam that I'm picking up on. And I'm going to basically use it as a landmark. So I'm going to draw it in. And that's going to become a point at which other forms start developing. Back here on the heel, this contour is actually inserting behind this. So I'm going to make sure I emphasize that. And that starts creating the idea of bulkiness or volume, one thing overlapping another. And overlap, where you have something overlapping another, you have an immediate understanding visually that this is in front of that. This is a spatial relationship. One thing is forward of another thing. And that helps you create a sense of depth and volume in your drawings so you don't end up with flat shape outline drawings. You can use this method and these principles with anything that you draw. And with enough practice, they become basically inherent. They're ingrained in you so that you don't really have to think about the principles anymore. You just draw. And you think about how you want to express the form that you are trying to depict. The other thing to understand is that there are parts of any three-dimensional form that you can't see when you're looking at any particular part. And that's really important to understand because it helps you draw accurately. That this line here actually wraps around the other side and disappears where we can't see it and then emerges over here. Another thing to remember is that everything has edges, and edges are three-dimensional. So if you just draw an edge like this with a single line, it doesn't really communicate much. If you consider that there is a top plane on that edge and a side plane, then you have something. You can also see I don't use the eraser much. I just let my search lines sit there because it's kind of a roadmap of where I've been and developing and trying to understand the form. Again, this is not a finished drawing. For me, drawing is a little more preliminary to painting, and so the drawing is more a study issue than a finished work of art. But it still needs to communicate well. So the drawing is going to show my corrections, and I'm not embarrassed about that. I'm not ashamed of that. I just got used to, a long time ago, not using the eraser to correct mistakes. Because especially early on, you're going to spend a lot more time correcting mistakes with the eraser than you will actually drawing stuff. Now, something on the lace detailing here. Laces are kind of tedious to draw. They're linear form, and they can go all over the place. And so instead of trying to draw the laces, what I'm doing is setting up the little loops that the laces pass through. I'm doing that first, and that's going to give me the basis for actually laying in what the laces are doing. And then there's a funky loop here. And again, laces, these little loops, are also three-dimensional. One thing my drawing teachers always taught me, and it was pretty much every drawing teacher I ever had, was that you spend more time looking at what you're drawing than your actual drawing. So your eyes should be flitting back and forth from your subject to your drawing constantly. If you don't do that, then what you're drawing is an impression, but not the reality of what you're seeing. And the thing is, a lot of people draw that way. But to really understand something, you have to be staring at it and analyzing it with your head, making decisions about what you see, understanding what you see, in order to make a drawing that communicates something. And the reality is, drawing is a form of communication. And that's why you want to know how to draw accurately, fairly decently, so that you can communicate what you see, you can communicate your point of view, you can communicate your ideas. So I'm still just kind of setting things up here, looking how, where the laces are overlapping. And I'm not committing really to any shading yet. The one thing I might do with the eraser is lighten some of these heavier lines as I go, but that would be the only thing. So it gets really complicated up in here. It's a really nice curve on it. So as you can see, it's really messy, but that's okay, because this is a study drawing. It's not a finished product. The pencil that I'm using, by the way, is an HB, and so it's a fairly hard lead as drawing pencils go. If it's a 2B, 4B, or 6B, it's going to be softer. So HB is kind of in the center of pencil grading between hard and soft. There's no specific standard for pencil grading or the grading of pencil lead. So you have to try out different pencil brands to find out what you like working with best. This is actually a more severe angle here. And this line actually comes here before it ducks down. So this pencil that I'm working with, even though it's an HB, it's a fairly fat, and it has a large diameter on the lead itself, and so it's not going to give me extremely thin lines. So I might switch up a pencil. So this is a different brand. It's a 4B, so it's going to be softer. But the diameter of the lead itself is smaller, so the line that it makes is going to be thinner, as you see. by varying your line weight, the thickness, the density of the pencil, even with a line drawing, you can start playing around with the idea of depth so that with a heavier line or a darker line or thicker line, you create more weight. So even with a line drawing where you're not really going to do much shading, having something that has a thicker weight to it is going to help you give some dimension to it. I'm not worrying about color break, so the shoe is kind of a middle value tan and a darker value tan, and it has some blue-green laces on it. There's not a lot of light-dark difference to it, so if I try to focus on the color of the shoe, it's not going to communicate as well as if I focus on the light-shadow relationships, what the light and shadow are doing to reveal the form. We don't need color to see. We can see perfectly well black and white. So therefore, chroma, or the idea of particular bright colors, is not how we see. And we see basically because of light and dark. So in a drawing like this, which is grayscale, it's all light and dark values of gray. Color is not even an issue to help communicate what the form is doing. So I'm not going to worry about color breaks. In fact, the darkest part of the shoe is actually on the interior. So I'm going to bring the tongue forward because I'm going to darken the interior right here. That starts giving it some depth. Again, always try to think in terms of dimensionality. So something like this where there are ridges. Get that. Get those angles on those edges. And with a form that's fairly complex like this, there's a lot of details on this. Take it one detail at a time when you get to the details. Just slow down and look at each thing individually, study how it's actually formed, and then draw in order to communicate what's going on. So these treads are very much part of the character, the quality of the shoe. So they should not be neglected. Adding a cast shadow like this places the shoe on a surface, gives it some context, helps emphasize the idea of dimensionality. And it also keeps the object from just kind of floating in a great big empty space.